So, good afternoon, everyone. Thank you very much for inviting us to speak at your conference. I like what Allison said about living the life. And I hope that the second part of the presentations will give you some ideas on what tools you might be able to use to do that while you're going through your cancer journey. I'll be speaking about massage and other touch therapies offered at the Zakim Center. I'll take your questions, and then Dr. Liu will be presenting acupuncture. Now, that's only a few of the many things we offer at the Zakim Center. In fact, a lot of our group programs are also available for family members. So I just wanted you to take a note of that. Here's our next 20 minutes and how it's going to look like. The information that I have here for you today is really a consolidation of my education, some review of the research, but also, most importantly, stories like yours. For 11 years, I've been practicing as a massage therapist here, and my patients honor me with their stories, and that helps me hone my skill and my passion of massage and share that with you in the continuing for cancer care. Now, my aim is that after the end of this presentation, you would be able to answer two questions. Are you a good candidate for these therapies? And will these therapies work for you? What do we have to offer? We have oncology massage, which is actually modification of existing massage therapy techniques to safely work with all of you, your complications of cancer and cancer treatment. Now, depending on how we partner together, we might need to design other techniques, like if you need some lymphatic work, we can add some of that. If we need to do some scar tissue work because maybe you're not as mobile as you want to be, then we could add that. So this is all about together figuring out what's best. My colleague Teresa and I also are trained in reflexology, which mostly works on representations of the body, and you can do it either on the foot, the hand, or the ear. Currently, we are mostly practicing foot reflexology, but I am also trained in hand reflexology and some ear reflexology. We both also practice Reiki, which I think some of you are going to experience later. It's more energetic in the way that it works, but it's also using hands-on in the certain energy centers of the body. Now, if you're not comfortable with hands-on, we can also do this off the body for Reiki. Touch is vital to life. Touch is actually considered the mother of all senses. It's the first sense to develop in utero. So it seems to me that early on, right, we intuitively our body develops something to be able to receive and communicate with our environment to survive. Touch is also an intuitive tool. Now, I developed these slides before I actually got my boo-boo. But let me tell you, I did use the intuitive tool, grabbing onto my ankle as I fell off that step and automatically prepare, you know, doing Reiki on myself as I was waiting for the ambulance to pick me up. So how many of you have found yourself maybe rubbing your head or grabbing a part of your body when you hit it? It's something that we do automatically, right? The other thing that we do automatically is to use our touch to comfort others. Now, AT&T actually made a good thing about, what is it, reach out and touch someone. They made a lot of money out of that slogan, right? But this, again, is another thing that we do automatically. And in fact, this quality of touch is what got me in here. I use touch and massage for my father during his own cancer illness. Now, where does touch actually happen? I think I would be skipping a big thing if I didn't discuss skin, because this is where the receptors of touch are this is where they are located, as well as this is actually the biggest or largest organ of our body. But if you take a look at this trivia, a quarter size of your skin, how many cells is in there? How many sweat glands and blood vessels are in there? A lot of different organ systems, circulatory, central nervous system, and lymphatics, are interfaced in the skin, where touch first happens. So it's not unusual that the proposed mechanisms of action for massage and touch were in relationship to these systems that we find in the skin. Now, as I mentioned earlier, reflexology, usually what they've seen is that it's mostly interacting with the central nervous system and affecting the body in that way. With Reiki, it's more the relaxation response. But all of these actually describe how massage might work. However, these proposed mechanisms are very, very difficult to measure. In 2012, though, scientists actually performed muscle biopsies to take a look at an athlete's reaction after they rode a bike, and then they biopsied the muscle to take a look at what happens after massage. And they did get some findings in regards to effects on the inflammatory response. But let me ask you, would you want to be part of that study? Like, I don't think that doing invasive procedures is a way to really prove that these mechanisms work. It could be, but they're always going to tell us we need more studies. So the next couple of slides are actually more studies on the benefits of massage and Reiki and reflexology rather than the mechanisms. This is taken from the Society for Oncology Massage, which is a national organization for oncology massage therapists, and it's a literature review. As you can see, thousands of papers showing a similar pattern. The value of massage in cancer care, symptom relief, and palliation and support. Decrease in anxiety and other symptoms, as well as depression, stress, fatigue, all those things. This particular slide is a specific study on thoracic surgery patients. Now, this study was not all cancer patients. They did some studies as well in patients with different illnesses. But I would imagine that the surgical pieces might have been similar to yours. And the bottom line is that massage was an important additional pain management component of the healing experience for these patients. They also interviewed the clinicians for this study, and even the clinicians were happy about the results of this for their patients. It reminds me of the times when I go to the Brigham and Women's and do massage for patients there. Not only are the patients happy that they're getting some other treatment other than medications, but the doctors and nurses also tell me all the time, wow, I'm happy to be able to offer something else, you know? Now, this particular study of for Reiki was done here at the Dana-Farber, and it actually compares Reiki and the relaxation response, relaxation therapy. Again, what does it show? Same thing. Decrease in anxiety, depression, and increase in quality of life. I think you will hear a little bit more about the relaxation response later in Patty's presentation. Now, this is the research review for reflexology. What do we see? Same thing. Increased quality of life, decreased pain, decreased physical and emotional symptoms. And the 2012 study on breast cancer I wanted to include because it showed some trends in improvement in breathing and performance and daily tasks. And probably you might be able to deduce a lot of the breast cancer patients have the same muscles that are compromised, chest, upper back area, when they undergo their own surgeries. Here are some symptoms that have been reported by my patients in the 11 years that I've been here. Again, what do we see? The same thing, right? Pain, anxiety, depression, fatigue, insomnia, nausea, neuropathy are alleviated. Another thing that I would want you to think about is if you take a look at the symptoms, you might be able to see that if you had one of them, some of the other symptoms might follow as well, like a cycle. So if you chose one modality to cut that cycle, you might be able to reduce not just one symptom, but more or all of the things that you're feeling. Almost always my patients report that they feel good, they feel better, less stressed, and more relaxed. And in association with that, they report that they have a greater enjoyment for life, and also sometimes they have a different way of looking at their illness. It's almost like a different point of view, enjoying the living part, not just dealing with the cancer part. So what do our research and clinical experience tell us? In summary, our take-home message here is that there is a pattern of outcomes. I know we're always going to have more research. That's a fact, right? Regardless of whether it's integrative or conventional medicine or trials. But there is a pattern of outcomes: improvement in quality of life, helping decrease cancer and cancer treatment symptoms, and supporting and enhancing your healing and well-being. I also wanted to point out what the stand of the government was on these treatments. For massage, they agree. There's a lot of research already. It might be conflicting and we might need more, but there's a lot out there. Other important thing we need to remember is there appears to have few risks. It's relatively safe to receive massage therapy. For Reiki, they say that research is limited. That is true. It's actually more limited than massage. But I want you to remember what our clinical experience is here. They also say that Reiki appears to be safe as well, with no serious side effects being reported. Right now, they do not have any information on reflexology on their site, but I know that there are lots of groups out there that are doing research, ongoing research on reflexology. So what is the take-home message number two? Touch therapies are effective and safe as long as we follow some of these caveats. We encourage you not to use this as a replacement for medical treatment. That's why it's called integrative. We want you to use them in conjunction with your medical treatment. We want you to inform your healthcare provider if you are using any of the mind-body practices. Here at the Zakim Center, if you do come to see us, we do report or give an update to your doctors that you have come to see us, as well as we write it in your notes. So any time that they want to check our notes, they can do that. It's in your chart. They also want us to use a credentialed and trained professional who specializes in oncology patients so that they can make it safe for you. So if you choose not to come to the Zakim Center, I want you to have some of the tips that is also from S4OM in the skill sets that you might want to ask your therapist to have. In their website, they also have questions that you can take with you. I actually advise you to call people first and ask them those questions and make sure they're comfortable seeing you. That way, you can also gauge from your phone call, is this a person I want to partner with? This is a very small font, but I just want to give you an idea of the list of things that we need to know and assess before we actually see you and create a safe session for you. So all these tips can be found in the Society for Oncology Massage website. So knowing all that, I go back to the question, are you a good candidate for massage, reflexology, or Reiki? If you answer yes to one or more of these questions, then you may be a good candidate. So I encourage you to just kind of take a pause, take a look at these questions, and see where you're at. Well, and the other question, is it going to work for you? I really can't answer that. But I hope that from this information, you will be able to make a comfortable decision in deciding whether you want to try it out. And hopefully I can hear from you the answer of whether it works for you or not. Thank you very much for listening, and I hope you enjoy the rest of your afternoon. I'd like to take some questions if you do have any right now. Yes, please. That's okay.
I'm an extremely active person, have been my entire life. I don't ever sit still. I don't ever stop moving. So I did try that and didn't think it would do any good. I mean, and in the moment, it did feel good. But I jumped off the table and I said, wow, so I don't feel I had any long-term relief. So what do you suggest for someone like me? I do enjoy the water. So because of my physical, I do physical therapy in the water. And that seems to work because I'm active and the water doesn't offer resistance.
Mm-hmm.
Is that a good second, do you think? Or
This is why we have like different options and tools. Because not one thing is going to work for us. It's kind of like the way I look at it is, you decide what you choose to put in your toolbox. You wouldn't only have a hammer in your toolbox, right? You'll have a screwdriver, pliers, different things. So if that works for you, absolutely, I would say make that as a big part of your toolbox. The temporary effects of massage actually sometimes can be prolonged by a more consistent schedule, if that's something that is actually logistically possible. That's some of the things that I also help my patients decide, because I understand there's also a financial component to this as well. So it's all about, it's kind of like figuring out, well, what do we have? What works for me? You know, what are my resources? But yes, if you have found something that calms you down and works for you, this is a very good alternative to these.